All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Jason Chen. Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Hello?
Oh, man.
All right, maybe I should stay tethered. All right, how about now? I guess we're good. All right. So my name is Jason Chen, and I flew down from San Francisco. My business is called Magic Spark. And I'm here to present theming with Zen, which is based off the Zen theme or Zen theming system. So so today we're going to cover what is Zen theme and how to create sites with it with very little effort, how to set Zen up and create a sub-theme, and a better understanding of CSS, and why I believe you should only start with Zen, and also how to step on it just the right way. So a little background. When I first started theming or using Drupal, I took Garland and just made a mess of it. And I don't know, have you guys does anyone else here share the same story with me? Okay. And so it made Drupal not so much fun. It just made it yet even more confusing. So I wish I had known about Zen earlier, and but here I am. Has anyone not used Zen yet? Okay, cool. All right, great. So, and in the room, how many of you are more from the development side? Okay, and how many are you more from the design or creative side? Okay. Well, okay, great. So this talk is also a lot about how I like to use CSS. So hopefully that'll help. All right. So what the Zen theme and this theming system is, it's a excellent clean base to create with. There are other theming systems like the Studio or other things like that that offer a lot of very good package functionality, but it's an excellent clean base to create with. Some people might say there's a lot of extra code in there, but if you can step around it, it's actually not that bad. Another thing is that a lot of large shops use their own theming systems and templates. Is this thing just acting up, or is it just me? Sorry. Hopefully that'll work. Can you hear me now, or is it not? Did I screw it up? Shit. Is there a way, is there like a volume on these things, or? All right, sorry. So a lot of large shops have their own theming systems, and if you're just a small shop like myself, it's nice to have something that you can reuse and have the firepower of what a larger shop may or may not have, and so that's one of the other things that I think is beneficial about it. Another thing is by using a theming platform, you have a standardized workflow. So you're not always rethinking how to put a site together or how to bend the look and feel. There's also some nice SEO benefits from it in that Garland's page template puts navigation in a funny spot, whereas Zen will put a lot of the basic information in front in the stack so that when a machine or a search engine comes and reads your site, it's not going to have to traverse all the navigation and whatnot. Is the audio? Okay, cool. But mostly what I like about it is the CSS space that it provides, and I'll go into that a little bit more later. There's also some excellent features in template.php. If you take a look at other systems, there's other trends like, is Matt here? Matt, the guy in the back, I don't know if you guys went to the pre-process function stuff, but there's a lot of things that also offers, but just right off the bat, it sort of sets things up for you. The other thing is that, I'm primarily a site builder, designer, sort of developer. Through this theme, I've been able to give these talks, and for me, it's a nice way to engage in the community. So if you if let's say you use, you know, Zen and you wanted to ask a question, well, you could jump on the IRC and, you know, we all have a common place of you know, to talk about. So that's another point of you know, what I like about this. Other modules that I recommend you use are the Drupal administration menu. I use backup and migrate, but you can also, you know, do that through the command line. CCK, and I hope you guys all know about CCK. Does everyone not know about that yet? Okay, good. Image cache, of course. Menu block. Have you guys used that yet? Okay, what's nice about menu block is it allows you to load the menu system as a block, but it provides additional classes to reach in and make adjustments to specific menu items. So maybe just by talking about it, it'll come back and you'll see it again. Path auto is another, like, don't leave home without it kind of module. Is anyone not using this yet? Okay. So what path auto does is it, you can use tokens to automatically generate your URL aliases. And so what's nice about that is if you, let's say, wanted to set block visibility on this certain section of your site, well, Path Auto will dynamically create all those URL aliases for you. So that's another key one, and as well as views and web form. So pretty much on all my sites, you will find these modules. Okay, in addition, there is this reference sheet that kind of breaks down a lot of how the Zen regions, where they are. So it's on the Palantir website, and I should have downloaded this already, but it gives you a nice breakdown of the various regions within Zen. Is it making across? Okay. So to begin with, there's a nice breakdown of how the layout system works within this, within Zen. There's a as you know, there's like Yahoo Grids and the 960, you know, based systems for laying out websites, and Zen has its own that's done through layout fixed or layout liquid. You know, it basically arranges how your site is organized. And this cheat sheet gives you a nice breakdown of how that all works. So if it doesn't make sense at first, here's a resource for you. Okay. So a few examples before I get in and start making a sub-theme. Let me just show you a couple sites real fast. Oops. Let's see here. So this is a wine bar based in San Francisco. It's in the Four Seasons Hotel, and this is a Zen sub-theme. And here's an example of what, you know, how I go about doing my design work. And this is Drupal 6, and you know, basically all the CSS is just pretty much done by overriding what Zen puts out. And so it's, you know, it's got some nice stuff in here, but here's an example of you know, one of the sites that I've done with this. So let's see here. So this is like, you know, your basic view. All right, so another example, let's see. This is a meal delivery service. It's Drupal 5, but it's yet again a Zen sub-theme. And shows an example of, you know, I'm doing a lot of this work by simply just overriding the CSS. And I'll demonstrate that a little bit later. But it definitely provides, I mean, I like to think that the sites I create are unique. And Zen has been a huge part of enabling me to do that, so I hope that that makes sense. So, you know, just another example. All right, so let's come back to presentation. Okay, so I normally demonstrate this online, but I'm going to do it locally, but I'm going to show you now how easy it is to set up Zen, okay? So to begin with, I started using MAMP recently, by the way, and I used to like to have my own local setup, but if you haven't, if you're using a Mac and you haven't started using MAMP yet, I highly suggest you do so, because it actually does a lot of configuration and setup for you that makes having a local development environment, you know, like easy. So to begin with, if you look at my themes directory, there's nothing here. Has anyone not installed a theme yet, or not know how to do that? Okay, all right. So there's nothing in here. Here's a basic site. Let me show you like this. So it's basically just, you know, Garland for now, okay? Has a couple view slideshow, things like that. So, you know, that's, you know, basic site, okay? So let's come back to our folder. Let's get rid of that. Let's hide you. Okay. Oh. So it's out of here. Set of sites. Oh, by the way, I've been putting my files directory inside of all, and I really like that, so that if you ever needed to back up your entire site, you got everything right there. So if that makes sense, that's been my new favorite little move to do. So inside my themes directory, I've already downloaded the tar file from the Zen site. I'm going to extract it, and then inside of Zen, there's a folder called Starter Kit. Okay, this is basically all you really need to like really mess with at first. And so what I'm going to show you now is just out of the box how much I can get done with just this sub-theme. Does anyone not know what sub-themes are with regards to a parent theme? Okay, all right, cool. All right, so to begin with, I recommend you simply just duplicate Starter Kit, and then I'm going to call it Verde, which is the name of this theme, and then I'm going to rename this guy the .info file, which basically has the nuts and bolts of your theme, and I'm going to open that up in my text editor. There is a script to do this, I know it's kind of easy to demonstrate this locally as well, but you can also do this. On my site, I do have a script that you can run that actually replicates the starter kit. So I'm going to search for starter kit and replace with Verde, okay? And it says it found it in these three folders or these files, and hit replace all. And it updates, all your calls that were once starter kit. So let's rename this now to your theme name. So let's call this Verde. Okay. And we're going to call the description Drupal Camp LAX Demo. Okay. All right, so I'm going to hit save. And it's also save on these guys. Okay, so now if we return back to my themes directory, you'll see that there's now Zen as well as this sub-theme that we just made, okay? So I'm going to click enable and set that to be default. Hit save. And this is what you get. You get a whole lot of nothing, which is kind of good in a way. I mean, you may see some extra stuff underneath the hood, but basically what I'm trying to communicate is Zen isn't about a look and feel. It's about giving you a base to make a look and feel. And so some of the things we could do now, so if we look at this in Firefox, you can see we basically have pretty much not that much, you know. So let's say, for example, if I... Okay, so let me see. I thought I had a breadcrumb appearing. I might have to refresh that. Let's see here. I'm going to refresh. There's all caches. Looks like this might be set. Okay, sorry guys. So if I go to configure, there's a few options it provides, so you can turn things on and off as you do normally. But I could turn the display of breadcrumbs on and off just within this you know, web UI. So there's a lot right here that you know, you don't have to do that much to make this work. So if you hit save, you'll notice that the breadcrumbs will come back on. See. So let's go ahead and turn those off because I don't want them in this design. Okay, no. Okay, great. And then what else? Okay, so does this make sense so far? This should be like basic, like simple stuff, right? Any questions so far? Okay, all right, cool. All right, so now let's go back to our .info file. And some of the things that how Xen works is it breaks out your CSS in three different files. Oops, my template. There's the layout, and in this case, we're going to use layout fixed so that it locks things down to a 960 wide website. Okay. So if I simply just type in layout fixed, and also HTML elements. What's nice about this is it's separating out your layout of how your page should be rendered with CSS, and furthermore, it's allowing you to separate all your typography. So if you wanted to globally change all your type, it's sort of broken out for you to see. So that's a nice thing about it. So what I'm going to do now is inside of the Xen folder, it comes with HTML elements and layout. So I'm simply just going to copy these guys into here. And actually, I'm going to put in one at a time. So now you see what happens here is suddenly the layout kicks in. Oh, I have to flush the cache, sorry. Remember to flush your cache if you're messing with your theme. Sometimes it kind of helps to kick things through. So now, just by loading that CSS, I'm suddenly looking a little bit more like a site that I may want, you know. So that's just out of the box. I really haven't done much to kind of begin to bend this somewhere. Let's put in HTML elements. Okay. I don't know if I have to refresh. Yeah, because I did. Let me flush my cache again. Okay. So now you can see it's beginning to, you know, yet again take form and begin to look at like something else. So my approach when I make these sites, by the way, is I simply override what's in there. I don't actually copy and paste these and edit the files. I prefer to override them, and that's all done with specificity, and I'll go into detail about that later. So now, again, I haven't done much, and now inside of this file here is where I do all my work. It's just pretty much CSS. And again, I didn't copy and paste. I basically just wrote this from scratch. And if you're familiar with CSS, that's all you kind of really need to do. So let's put this guy in. And let's refresh the cache one more time. And then it looks like this. So just with that little file, you can get a lot of work done. Any oohs, ahs yet? Anything? No? Okay, well, I think it's kind of cool. I mean, basically, what I'm trying to communicate, oh, and I forgot my images, that's going to help too. Sorry, I forgot a part. So inside of here are just a few images, okay? So just with a little bit of effort, you get a lot out of the box with Xen. So let's say if I wanted to, you know, get rid of some of this stuff. Well, this is where you might want to start, you know, rather than saying, you know, finding that object and hiding it, this is where you should now begin to use pre-process functions. And there's a lot of that in the studio theme, and you can sort of replicate what's going on there. So, for example, if I look inside the template.php file, and you scroll down in here, you'll see two spots where you can do a couple little moves here. So here's the spot for page functions, and then below that are for nodes. So I have a little thing that right here. I'm going to copy these. So, for example, if I wanted to turn off the terms here, you could simply just do that by going inside your template. I'm just going to pop this here, paste, save, update my cache, and then it goes away. And it's whenever you can do this programmatically, you're much better off. So do take a look at those functions because they do give you a little bit more firepower. So let's put one more in. Let's get rid of that page title. And what this is saying is, in the case of a node of type of photo, turn off the title or unset the title. Okay. So now if I take a look at this page, it gets even cleaner. So that's an example of how you can also do some of this theming with a pre-process function. Any questions so far? Okay. All right. So how does this all work? Again, a lot of this is, you know, my approach is to basically override the layout and HTML elements, and then I put in all my styling with my sub-theme CSS. So in this case, it was called Verde.css. And a key part of this is leveraging the body classes that come that are printed with Xen. So if I take a look at my page here, inspect element. If you take a look up here inside of the body, you notice you have all these tags. And some people might say this code looks kind of bloated or there's all this extra crap in there, but for me, I see opportunity. I see access to mess with it. And so these body classes are kind of interesting. And to go into detail, you get like node type. So you could say for all stories, make the background green or something like that. Or if it's a web form, if the node type's a web form, do some little move to some navigation. Another powerful one is the section. So if you're like in the about section of a website, you can say set this menu ID to look, you know, bold or something, or add extra functionality. It's certain, you know, sometimes the active class is put into a menu item. Well, if you didn't have access to that, the section path is another way of reaching in and applying, you know, stylistic overrides. There's also one for the actual page path or URL alias, whether you're front or not front, whether it doesn't have sidebars, or if you're not logged in. So maybe you want to, you know, feature something for not, you know, unlogged in users or, you know, however. But how this all works is through specificity. And, you know, in order to really do a lot of this work with just CSS, you really need to understand how to do this cleanly. And so a year ago, I found this diagram that I felt really kind of like hit the message home for me. And so we're going to begin with a stormtrooper, and it's just an object. Can you read that in the back? Okay. So it talks about how when you declare a style, what's going to win? You know, what's going to be more specific? What's going to say, actually, my declaration means more than yours? And so beyond just the order of how things load, you can actually just be a little more specific about, you know, what you're trying to say. So, so by chaining things, by placing them in different orders, you're being more specific. But once you get to an ID, which is where we have the, that guy's a Sith or something like that? That definitely is going to up the ante on what's going to win. And this is different than using like the exclamation point important sign. This is far better if you could do it like this. So sometimes when I need to put in an extra little bit of CSS that I in this some weird use case that I need something else to win, I might use, for example, the ID of page and then the ID of main, and then whatever follows that is pretty much going to win. Does that make sense? Because in your how your HTML structure, that's those pretty easy hooks to get into there with. So again, if you take a look at how the Verde site was done, or a lot of the sub themes I have, let me see, where's go back to here. You can see here how a lot of that's being declared. So for example, in the section of portfolio, make the sidebar left have this override. So does that make sense? Does it not make sense? I mean, this is kind of important. So this is kind of how I do all my work. So if it's confusing, I would like to explain it. If it's like a node type of whatever, so in this case, I did actually hide something because I was kind of leaving it in there for it to be picked up by a search engine, but I did hide something there. But again, you can kind of see how this is all working. So how's everybody doing? Have I opened any doors? Have I closed doors? Are you guys not liking Zen? Are you liking Zen? I mean, questions? Anything? Yeah?
Sidebar.
Uh-huh.
Is there another example that the sidebar is actually different in another section?
Yeah. So in other words, on this site here, I probably should have pulled a better example, but this is the sidebar right here, right? Mm-hmm. So if I go to sidebar left, if I were to just, make this a little skinnier, you could see that stuff's moving around. But here, the sidebar is set to there. So in that section, that sidebar should kick out a bit more because it's, had some graphics in there and I wanted to sort of render things a little bit differently. So that's an example. Let's take a look at Press Club. So I had these, the secondary menu or ID of secondary. Here, it just, it loads down here. But if we take a look at this, it says in the section about the margin left should be 10. Well, let's say if I wanted to stick this guy over like there. See? I'm moving it around. So I would bet that in section wineries, the sidebar left margin is going to be like 110 or 108 or something. So in this case here, actually this was a slightly different one. Let's see what we did here. Inspect. Margin left one like that. So by using the section path of the URL alias that's printed in the body class, you could say when this class occurs, make this ID do this. Does that make sense? Okay, cool. All right. So that's an example of how to use this with just CSS to make stuff move around. Any other questions? Yeah?
I know there's a project to do the 960 grid system uh-huh. together. Have you gotten a chance to play around with that at all?
Well, the thing, okay, I'm kind of at this weird place because the latest version of Zen, like version 2.0, I put on a site and then I swear to you, typically with my site builds, I do all my work, CSS, I look in IE, and I might have like one or two little kind of things to tweak, but it's really minimal. And then the latest version, like my site totally blew up in IE, and I don't know what happened because some things significantly changed in the latest Zen as far as how IE is reading the CSS. So to answer your question, I'm probably going to stay with this, and then I might eventually begin to move more pre-processed functions into a lot of my workflow. And so I'm probably just going to stay with what's been working great so far and sort of modify where Zen's been going, because I'm not sure if the new upgrades are they need some cleaning out, basically. And also, I don't mind doing my overrides. I mean, you know, it does make sense to me. I think if I had a large site, I might write my parent layout stuff to behave more accurately to what I want, and then have maybe I'll have a sub-theme load per section, or per, if it's a multi-site, I might maybe have some of those overrides, you know, occur at that point. But I generally just plug in Zen and do these simple overrides. For a layout, that is, yeah?
Also, have you messed around with the wireframe CSS? What does it do?
Well, what it does is it allows you to see what's going on, and I don't use it so much because I've been doing this. I've done, like, I don't even know how many websites with Zen that I don't really. I mean, I kind of know where stuff is now, you know. So let's take a look here. So what this does is it gives you kind of like how Firebug does, but gives you basic breakouts of your IDs and stuff. So this would be sidebar left. This would be content, header, content. I forgot the ID name. Content area, and then, you know, main, header, etc. So with wireframes enabled, you could see pretty fast, you know, where things are being declared, if that makes sense. Any other?
Going back to your line bar site.
Uh-huh.
The secondary menu is a URL, right? How do you do two
columns? For that one, well, to make matters worse, the first iteration of the site, I actually used text image to make those bitmaps, so it got pretty bad. But here, I think what I'm doing is I think I loaded them as standard items, and this is one UL, I believe. Can't remember. Yeah, it is. And it's basically going, it's kind of sneaky, but it's going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. What's that?
So you're floating.
Well, yeah, I mean, you can set the width of the LI to have a certain, you know. So I think the width on these guys will probably be, let's see, go up here, it's 250. So in the section of wineries, in navbar, set secondary links UL, you know, LI of this width and float left. So if I were to turn that off, things would get a little screwy. So, you know what I mean? So by declaring a constant width, that's how I did it there. But it's kind of weird because you have to sort the menu items a certain way. So I don't know. I mean, that's how I did it there. Another question? Okay, so how do you guys like to use Zen? Any things anybody wants to say that they'd like or don't like, or yeah, in the back? Okay, how would I put scripts in? Okay. Suckerfish menus. Okay. The. See, I don't. That comes in as a. Does that print? It's a block. I'm not sure. Does that load as a block? I don't know. Does it? Yeah. Okay, so we'd come in, so in this case, what we could do, let's say, for example, if I wanted to come down here and load some JavaScript into my site, I could just do that through the .info file. So in this case, you know, oops, could just uncomment that, or if I wanted to load other scripts, I would go through there and put that in. But I haven't used the suckerfish thing, so I don't know how to advise. But that's where I would advise slipping scripts and additional CSS and other things. Like if I wanted to put a PNG script in here, I would kick it off through there. And again, take note, I didn't touch my page template. I don't even have to. You know, I'm doing all this work just by messing with my .info files and some stuff in template.php, and again, mostly with just CSS. So, yep.
Do you find yourself having to do a lot of absolute positioning within a relative div?
The question was, do I absolute position stuff? And yes, I do. And sometimes it's a little annoying, but I don't know. It's working. I mean, I don't know of that many gnarly bugs. I mean, part of my background is I started in traditional graphic design in like '89 and did a lot of print. So I really show up as an artist when I make these websites. So I might do some things that are a little weird, but you know, the absolute positioning of divs hasn't killed me yet. You know, things I believe are fairly bug free as far as I could tell. Yeah.
You mentioned specificity earlier. When I work on a site, I often come back to a certain element. I want to change it when a client wants to change something. Now, how do you change your CSS file according to...
Okay.
Do you go resort your CSS file?
Well,
I mean, they get pretty large.
Thank you. First and foremost, whenever I make a site, I prototype as fast as possible, and sometimes in front of my clients, and just whip up my module configuration, my this and that, just so that I don't have to do that. Because when I do a lot of this work, you kind of have this concept of, okay, it's going to be like this. And therefore, your brain thinks, okay, I'll write it like this. And then all of a sudden, a client asks for something weird, and then like you're like, okay, what do I do now? So how that's typically handled in my business is, I hate to say it, but often is how grumpy I am for making the change. I mean, like a lot of people like to be super clean about this stuff, and I tend to be, but if it's like a quick little fix, I might kind of slip in something a little more specific in that case. But if it justifies an architectural shift, I'll just say, okay, let's do it and just focus on it and get it done. And by, you know, if you understand that with Zen you're getting this layout of your page with CSS that's pretty solid. If you know how to just bend it just right, or simply bend it, you're getting a lot. You're leveraging all that functionality that was given to you from the get-go. So these things do pretty much hold up. Another way of perceiving this is when I am doing these overrides, I try to be as minimally specific as possible, or globally specific, so that I don't just arbitrarily pick a class that I can grab onto. I do take a moment to think, you know, actually, I think I'll use this one, you know, because you see how it pertains to the rendering your design. Does that make sense? Okay, cool. Any other CSS questions, or what do you guys like to use for your CSS editing? VB Edit? VI. Do you guys know about this thing called CSS Edit?
I use it.
What I like about doing this is, let's say if I wanted to say, like, you know, page, code hinting is kind of nice. I don't know if VB Edit does that for you, but, you know, that I find that pretty useful. You know, you could just, you know, type in whatever, 12px. So the code hinting I find to be pretty useful. So, you know, if you wanted to just do whatever, it helps me type things faster. So, I hope all you are using Firebug as well. Does anyone not use that yet? Okay, cool. Okay. Anybody have any trouble with Zen that they're didn't understand why it did something. Yeah?
I have a question. There's a content fix, and where is there content for equal columns?
For what?
Equal columns.
Okay, so equal columns meaning that there's two columns or there's two sidebars of fixed width and the middle stretchy?
Two columns, fixed width.
Two columns, fixed width. So the two columns like this?
Yeah.
Okay. I believe it's set up so that in Zen, the margin widths are set to a fixed width. I don't think the margin stretch and fit. I think how they did it was, let's take a look. I think they did that as liquid slime CG. Where should I have margin width? Or actually, it should be width. I believe how that's done in the stretchy or liquid is they set the margins to be a fixed width, but that could be overridden by. Are you using on this example, this two column example? Are you using both sidebars or just one? Okay, then I don't know about the design, but you could just say sidebar left or sidebar first with 50% and, you know, content would have a width of 50% as well, and then you would float them, and that would, you know, do that trick. And you could actually do that by overriding the CSS as well that's in Liquid. Does that help?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I mean, if you get stuck, you can always email me. So, guys are awfully quiet. I hope I didn't bore you. yeah?
Well, there's a couple of other sort of basic starter themes, if you will, like Zen.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned Studio related, it's probably both on the other ones.
Uh-huh.
You use various things like Sacrifice drop down, etc. Why specifically did you use Zen? Because, I mean, when you look at the file you download, I mean, the instruction just to sort of customize things are work. I often find myself restarting or creating things from scratch,
mm-hmm.
just because it seems easier my mind, my workflow, than just keeping changing.
Yeah. Well, the reason is because when I first made my first Drupal site, I didn't know better, and I hacked Garland, and I got so frustrated that I'm like, okay, I'm putting this in line by line. And if I didn't understand what it was, I didn't put it in. And that forked me on this weird path where I was leaving out half of Drupal because I just thought I wanted a clean template. And so after a while, I'm like, okay, let's start over and let's just try on Zen. And let's just step on it as minimally as I can. And that's kind of what I've been doing for the past year and a half. And I make a site probably, I don't know, like one a month. And so I just got stuck in my way of doing it like this. So, but I mean, if it was a huge project and a huge site, no, I wouldn't just override Zen. I would rewrite Zen and then sub-theme from there. But, you know, typically my sites are not that, I don't have those kind of budgets. So, yeah. Any other questions? How many guys are from LA? How many of you are not from LA? Wow. Are any of you from Northern California? Okay. Well, I think we may have our DrupalCon coming to the Bay Area. It's not official, but that's something kind of cool. So, and if you come up for that, I'll be throwing a party at Zeitgeist. It's a bar in San Francisco, so. What's that? Drupal Con? I believe it should be in March.
Yeah, but where would they hold that?
Oh, I think they put in a proposal. I think they mentioned Moscone.
They did.
Yeah. Yeah, so. Well, I think I went that a little too fast, but I hope you see, or I hope I've communicated. Are those who of you who have not used Zen yet, are you convinced or not convinced, or?
Try it out. Let's see.
All right. All right.
There's so much information within Zen that at the beginning it comes a little more overwhelming than what I used to write myself.
Right. Right.
So a little more confusing because it's for somebody else's thought process.
Absolutely, I totally get what you're saying, and I used to build my sites from scratch all the time, but then after a while, I just started really streamlining my workflows with Drupal, and there is a lot of extra stuff in there, but it doesn't drastically affect your load times, and if you know how to work within all the things presented to you, my site building time is dropped immensely because I've been following this workflow. So I make pretty much build out these.
Do you find yourself reusing pieces of sort of Zen sub-themes
a lot? The stuff right here, this forum stuff, you'll see this block on the majority of my sites. And what that is it just does, if I go to contact us, let's go to a forum, let's go to a mailing list. A lot of this stuff, and I might change the color, do some width changes and stuff like that, but that's a case of when I reuse my own code. Yeah?
Can you plus that little chunk of form CSS on this event?
Sure, you can also, just so you know, I am looking, like this is a live site, you can also just go like this and go inspect element.
I'll forget.
But it could show you how to do this, though. So then you simply just hold on the command key and you click on that, and then you can see all the CSS right here. This is before I used CSS edit, and I just kind of typed it out. But so this is not as sexy looking right here, but it's just pretty much there. But I will I'll do a blog post about the CSS I reuse across my sites. Okay? So, alright, well, I'm also doing two other things. One's tomorrow on UberCart, and if you're interested, it's going to be very basic, like how to make an e-commerce website, real fast. I'll build one in like a half hour. And then at the end of the day, tomorrow, I'm going to be demonstrating the WYSIWYG API and module, so you can basically enable things like Tiny MCE. And the thing that's special about the afternoon one will be showing how you can use inline images without IMCE, and it's using the file field insert thing, which is pretty cool. Hopefully I'll get more oohs and ahs from you then. Well, thank you for coming. Thank you.